Welcome to our module Sustainable Biopolymers. In today's lecture, I would like to present another example of biopolymers. So success stories where we have 100% bio-based polymers, polylactic acid, polyhydroxyalkanoates, where depending on the application, both polymers are also fully biodegradable. This is also implicated in this graph. You might wonder why the percentage looks a little bit different. Here are only the polymers shown which are biodegradable. So a large share are covered by PLA, polylactic acid, 24%, and a smaller share by the polyhydroxyalkanoates with 6%. PLA is rapidly increasing, and interestingly, we see also competition. We have with NatureWorks from the US, the major producer, in 2018 of 150 kilotons per year. Corbion, it's a company from the Netherlands, with Total, a company from France, in a joint venture, produced close to their lactic acid plant in Thailand, a polylactic acid plant with a capacity of 75,000 kilotons per year. And then there's a Dutch company, Simbra, producing 50,000 kilotons per year. Remember that these scales are clearly industrial. You see it also how such a plant looks like from NatureWorks. This is too industrial scale. However, compared to the entire plastic market, you remember these are in the millions, in the hundreds of million tons. This is a small share. We discussed it previously, that it's the entire bioplastics are less than 1%. But there is growth, there's significant growth. We see it in the companies investing and in the new plants investing. For example, with the PHAs, there are suggestions that there's a high potential and that production capacity increases threefold only in 5 years from 2016 to 2021. With PHA, one has to say, this was mentioned over and over again because these polymers have interesting properties and can be produced so nicely. However, there were all the time market issues, market hindrances, that it did not happen. Let's go a step further back in more detail. We can use renewable resources. We can use melasse from sugarcane. We can use sugar beet. We can also use corn as a carbon source. Feed microbes traditionally. It was maybe with lactic acid bacteria producing lactate, the acid, and importantly, there are two isomers. You have the L or D form. And these can be polymerized to the polylactic acid. Actually, there's one step in between, a chemical conversion to lactide, and this can then be polymerized. Depending on the monomer you use, you also change the properties of the polymer. So not only molecular weight can be changed, but also with the L to D fraction properties of the polymer. If we have a brief look at the polyhydroxyalkanoates, which are discussed, as I mentioned before, for quite some time, they can also be used and produced from renewable feedstocks. And the same I mentioned just before, for example, corn and wheat starch. But more prominently, they're produced from vegetable oils and maybe from residual oils from cooking. And immediately then from fatty acids. They are fed as a carbon source. And here I show you the same picture I showed in a previous lecture. then the bioplastic is immediately synthesized by the bacterium, for example, via Pseudomonas putida. These would be medium chain fatty acids in the PHA polymer. And these fermentations you also have to consider to be of industrial scale if you want to be competitive. And this is achieved by a few companies for a simpler C4 polymer. And I will come up with one example where also the medium chain PHAs are produced. Then you have these polymers inside the cell, but you require them as a pure polymer. So you have to extract and purify the polymer from the bacterium. And the usual way is that there's some step of hydrolysis. It can be by pH that the cell lyses. It can be also by organic solvents or a combination thereof. And the organic solvent would also be used immediately to extract the hydrophobic bioplastic into the hydrophobic organic solvent. And by this, already separating all the water-soluble compounds of a cell, and would be a first step of purification. Here are two examples that PHA is a class of molecule. There are so many possibilities how you can influence the PHA polymer and thereby the properties. And then you can think about even blending via polymer chemists and material scientists. So two examples, the most prominent in literature because it was very easily produced by some wild-type bacterium. It's polyhydroxybutyrate, PHB. You see here the butyrate backbone. If you don't do any tricks, no extra molecules, you have a brittle and stiff material. It has very good water barrier properties, but it's brittle and stiff. So the use is in niche markets. And that was one of the issues that PHA increase did not happen as predicted. But there are far more exciting polymers. For example, PHB, so the hydroxybutyrate, polymerized with hydroxyvalerate. It has already an increased tensile strength. So it's not that brittle stiff, but you can pull it. And there are a lot of others. Actually, more than 150 different monomers are reported. And then you can think about blending them in the polymer. So you have different fractions of the copolymer. You can have block polymers. So only one monomer and then another monomer. Or you can even mix afterwards. If you have the different properties of your polymer, you mix them together to get to the final product. And doing manufacturing, plastic engineers can do wonderful things. So there's much to do. Actually, this is one of the hurdles PHA has to take. We think about value change from renewable resources to a bioplastic. But then we have to think about not only cost, this is a main driver. If the cost gets low, more people would look into it. But then we have to think about these material properties of the single polymer, but then also of the blended polymer and then of the final product. And this requires a lot of research. But as I mentioned before, I think a valuable part of research. And to end, I would like to show you one of these success cases. Kaneka, a Japanese company, is involved for quite some time, actually over 2 decades at least, in the PHA production. They have a bio-based production via plant oils. They have a vision to be more sustainable and also to reduce the cost by lignin-containing biomass, lignocellulosic biomass, as a feedstock. Let's see how that goes. Most of the products most of the polymers, resins, provided by Kanika are biodegradable. And interestingly, even biodegradable in a home composting. Also this we discussed before, the temperature in home composting is lower, the time required for biodegradation is far higher. But some of the resins work fantastic in home composting and even in cold seawater. And this may open some solution to the issues of bioplastics in the ocean. Resistance to heat and hydrolysis is still given, although it's biodegradable and it has a very good water vapor barrier feature. And there you can immediately imagine what kind of applications are possible. You can think about food packaging, trays and cups. Here are some of the examples. But you can also think about films. And there you can cover products. And more specialized, but most likely more higher priced, you can think about pharmaceutical capsules. Kanika can offer a variety of different resins. What do? They vary their two monomers, the hydroxybutyrate, and in their case, it's a C6, a hydroxyhexanoate. And by varying this, they can offer their customers different properties. With this exciting example, that they are actually already end-user products, but also offers to the industry to think about renewable and biodegradable plastics, I would like to end this lecture and thank you for your attention.